I'm glad you guys are excited. Let me just say, last week it was kind of awkward coming up here. What we did, we had an amp that died, and our sound guys got it going up really fast. So by the time I got up on stage last week, we already had sound, and they worked hard this morning getting everything all good. Can y'all just show them that you love them, that they do an awesome job? Just show them some love. I love those guys. If we don't have, like, audio-video stuff, then, like, we're kind of dead in the water. And I think that a lot of times we take things for granted in life. We can take birthdays for granted. We can take just the simple fact of oxygen for granted. I mean, we can take so many things for granted. We can take friendship for granted. We can take our kids for granted. We can take our parents for granted and our grandparents. But there's one common thing that I think that we typically all take for granted, and that is the Bible. I mean, it's so readily accessible. Like, we have so many of them, and they're so accessible, but yet, a lot of times, we don't know what to do with it or where to get started. And that's kind of where this whole idea from this series, like, from the beginning, like, if we can understand the Bible from the very beginning and kind of a general knowledge of all the way through, then whenever we open up the Bible, whenever we read it, we'd have a better idea about what we're reading. We can kind of understand it a little bit better. And I kind of shared with y'all before, I have a reading disability, so I can read a whole entire book or a whole entire, you know, page, and you ask me a question about it, and I can't tell you a single thing that I read. So I have to really read and study and study and study. And that's where I fell in love with the Bible, because I started reading, and it's like, man, this stuff is awesome. There's so many things in the Bible. And I'm going to kind of recap with you, like, kind of where we've been. And I got my props again with me. So we said that one of the things that major that happened in the Bible that was, like, from the very beginning was the creation. God made everything. He did it in 6 days. He did it on the seventh day. He rested. So there's my globe. And this time I stopped on Canada. So go Canada. So now, from the beginning, God created everything in 6 days. And on the sixth day, He created man. And He said that we are very good. And that's what we learned from the creation, that we are very good. Now, we went from very good, we kind of fell pretty fast. And so we have our little apple. We have Adam and Eve ate the fruit. And they had sin. And we learned that we all have sin. No matter how pretty we look, we all have sin. Now from there, it kind of got a little interesting, because we learned about the creation and then the fall. But then, here's my favorite part, because I got my wicked awesome 5 gallon bucket here. Because after that, you had the flood. And so I got my Pizza Plus little pitcher of water. We got the flood. So this is where Noah saved his family by building the boat. God told him to. So we had the flood. And through the flood, we learned that God made a provision for Noah and his family. They gave him the boat for him and the animals to get in. And so God had a perfect plan. And that even though sometimes there's chaos in our lives, and even times there's times that we have no idea what's going on, God has a perfect plan. And His name is Jesus. And He came to save us just like that boat did for Noah and his family. Now from there, it kind of got a little strange, because people began to repopulate the earth, and then they had this bright idea that, hey guys, earth is so bad, let's just go to heaven before anybody else does. Let's just make our own way. So they started building a stairway, like a tower to heaven. It's known as the Tower of Babel, the Tower of Confusion. So what God did was that He struck everybody to give them a different language. And we didn't really talk a whole lot about that, but it is kind of important, because some of us can speak Portuguese and Indianese and Japanese and Chinese. So we have all the different languages. Now, from there, God spoke to this man named Abraham. And this is one of my favorite parts, too. Spoke to a man named Abraham. And he says, Abraham, I'm going to make you into a great nation. Well, Abraham became really old. And he finally, him and Sarah, they finally had a son, Isaac. When he was really old, he was around 100 years old, finally had a son. And he only had one son. But then Isaac, he ended up having two sons, Jacob and Esau. Jacob got ended up changing his name to Israel, and he ended up having 12 sons, represented by the dozen eggs. And these 12 sons make up what's known as the 12 tribes of Israel. This is what makes up the nation of Israel. And it started there. From there, things got bad for the nation of Israel. They gave themselves over to slavery. They were so hungry that they sold themselves into slavery. They said to the Egyptians, hey, we will work for food. Literally, we will work for food. So they gave themselves over to slavery, and they held up the "we will work for food" sign. So they became in slavery. But the problem was is that life got tough for them, and they began being abused and beaten and overworked and underpaid. And I know we're all overworked and underpaid, but they were really beaten and beaten and beaten to try to make all these Egyptian buildings for the King Pharaoh. And while they were there, they started praying to God, God, get us out of this mess, get us out of this mess, get us out of this mess. And so God heard. He spoke to a man named Moses, represented by my wicked awesome Moses stick. And they spoke to Moses. And what Moses did is that he went down to Egypt, and he did all these amazing miracles. I mean, one of them we talked about last week, God told him, he said, I'm going to show you how powerful that I am, and I'm going to be with you. He said, take your stick, throw it on the ground. It turned into a snake. And then God said, okay, Moses, I want you to pick the snake up by the tail. And he did, and it turned back into a stick again. That's one of the miracles that he did. Another miracle he did, he touched the water. He touched the waters, and the waters turned his blood. He did other miracles Moses did, and where they had these plagues of locusts and these plagues of frogs that came. And God did this all through Moses. Well, finally, King Pharaoh, he finally let the people go. And as they were traveling, as they were leaving, they came to the Red Sea, and they were trapped. And they said, Moses, what are we going to do? We're better off as slaves. And then God spoke to Moses. He said, let's lead the people on. And so Moses, we don't know exactly how, but somehow Moses approached the water with his hands. God parted the Red Sea, and they crossed over on dry ground, and represented by the staff. And that was the Exodus, how they got out of slavery. From there, God led Moses and the Egyptians and to where to Mount Sinai. And on Mount Sinai is where God spoke to Moses. Moses was up on this mountain for 40 days and 40 nights. He didn't eat for 40 days or 40 nights. And while he was there, God gave the Ten Commandments, these set of rules represented by the ruler or yardstick. And we said that the whole purpose of the Ten Commandments is to show you where you're at versus where you need to be. So if we have a ruler, we can cut a piece of wood that may be 2 foot long, but we can cut it down to 16 inches where it needs to be. And it's the whole point of the Ten Commandments. It's to show us that we can't keep the Ten Commandments, and therefore we need Jesus. That's his whole point. And now if you cover all these things, we got, you know, the creation, the fall, the flood, the Tower of Babel, the birth of a nation, the Exodus, and now the Ten Commandments. We have covered the first two books of the Bible, Genesis and Exodus. That's it. There's a whole lot of stuff that happens in the Old Testament. And there's no way that today I can cover everything that happens in the Old Testament. There's so much stuff. But there's one thing that God speaks to people on. And he uses these people called prophets. And in the Bible, in the Old Testament, we have these prophets, and they had this one job. This one job. They are the mouthpiece. They are the voice of God to the people. Kind of like what preachers are today. And so what they do, and I have girl number two's Bible. This is Eliana's Bible. And what they would do is they would hear a word from God, and they would proclaim this out to the people. God would speak to Moses, or God would speak into these prophets we're going to talk about today. And he would tell them, tell this to the people. Tell them this. Lead them this. Do this. And so these prophets would proclaim whatever word God would tell them to. And so today I'm going to show you just a couple of prophets and what they did. And I believe that today is going to be absolutely awesome. So if you have your Bible, I'm going to set this one here. If you open up to the book of Joshua, you're going to see how God used this amazing man. And that Joshua did something absolutely crazy. And it started at the death of Moses. So we ended off last week with Moses and the Ten Commandments. Well, now a few things have happened, and now Moses is dead. And so this picks up in Joshua chapter 1 at the very death of Moses. Moses is now dead. And he speaks to Joshua. And so this is Joshua chapter 1, verse 1. And it says, after the death of Moses, the Lord's servant, the Lord spoke to Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' assistant. So he was Moses' right-hand man. And he said, Moses, my servant, is dead. Therefore, the time has come for you to lead these people, the Israelites, across the Jordan River into the land that I'm giving them. Now, this is a story that I know that many of us are familiar with, where what Joshua did here with the Moses is they end up crossing the Jordan River, but guess what? They did it on dry ground, just like they did with Moses. Moses crossed, led the people to cross the, my Bible fell. They led the Israelites to cross over the Red Sea on dry ground. Well, now Joshua's doing the exact same thing, but instead of the Red Sea, now it's the Jordan River. And the Jordan River wasn't that big, but still yet, God was showing everybody else that he was with Moses. He is now with Joshua. And Joshua leads them into this battle. And this battle is one of the most craziest battles you'll ever read. If I'm a general, if I'm a leader of an army and I'm going to go into battle, I'm going to count my swords, my guns, my tanks. I'm going to count my men. That's what I'm going to do. And I'm going to get a battle plan together. But what God told Joshua was, is that here's your battle plan, Joshua. instead of you focusing on your guns and your weapons, what you're going to do is you're going to lead your people to walk around the city of Jericho. For 6 days, you're going to walk around the city one time. But on the seventh day, you're going to walk around it seven times. And then you're going to blow your trumpets, and the walls are going to come down, and then you can go in and kill everybody. Now, does that sound like a good battle plan? To me, it really doesn't. It makes no sense. But that's what God led Joshua to do. And we know this as like the walls of Jericho, or the battle of Jericho, or the city of Jericho. And the walls come tumbling down. They fell down just by walking around. So if you can just imagine this, that if this was a city of Jericho, and I'm just starting to walk around this, I mean, would you not call me weird names? I need medication and a straitjacket. And if somebody was to call out you and say, hey, PJ, what are you doing? Well, I'm going to walk around this city one time for 6 days, and then on the seventh day, I'm going to walk around it seven times, and the walls are going to come tumbling down. Would you not enter me into Marion? Right? He's suicidal. He's crazy. This makes no sense whatsoever. But this is what Joshua taught us. Not just Joshua, but you'll see this in the prophets as well. They taught us that with God, we can do absolutely anything. It's about trusting God with complete obedience, regardless of how ridiculous it sounds. Because throughout the Bible, God does some amazing things, and it sounds ridiculous. I mean, does it not sound ridiculous that you would march around a city with your army, and instead of getting your guns and your bows ready, you're getting your shoes ready so you can march around it? I mean, it makes no sense whatsoever. But because God has orchestrated this plan, the walls come tumble down. This is what God does. And that's what I love is about Joshua, that he taught this. That he taught us that to obey God no matter what. And there's times in our lives that we're going to have to trust God when it sounds ridiculous. That we're going to have to trust God whenever it seems like we want to just quit, whether it be on our marriage or our job or our family. That we are going to have to trust God to lead us through this, even when it makes no sense whatsoever. I mean, if I'm Joshua, instead of saying, okay, God, that's what I'm going to do, I would argue. I mean, I did this with my parents a lot. They would say, hey, you need to go clean your room because of this. And I'm like, no, I don't. What? That makes no sense. Why do that? And on the farm, you know, Dad would tell us to do so. Well, we need to go out and, you know, hoe the garden and get the weeds out. Psst, they're fine. Those potatoes are going to grow with weeds in it or not. It makes no sense. So we would argue back, and I would want to argue back with God because it sounds ridiculous. God, give me something better to do. Like, let's sharpen knives. Let's sharpen our swords. Now, that's a battle plan. Not walk around the city. Let them make fun of us. You would be on the news for the craziest army ever. But we know the end results. The walls came tumbling down, and they took over that city. It's amazing. And you'd think that it would kind of stop there. Joshua, he is an amazing leader. He is an amazing man of God. Not only that, but he's also a prophet. I mean, he is just an amazing man of God. If you flip over just a few more chapters over to Joshua 10, they're getting ready to go into another battle. The Israelites, the nation of Israel, they're in trouble again. And they're getting ready to go into battle again. God meets with Joshua. And Joshua does something completely absurd. He prays, but I want you to listen to this. This is in Joshua chapter 10, verse 12. They're in battle. They're right in the heat of the battle. And it says in verse 12, on the day the Lord gave the Israelites victory over the Amorites, Joshua prayed to the Lord in front of all the people of Israel. And he said, now listen to what he prayed. Let the sun stand still over Gibeon and the moon over the valley of Ajalon. This is his prayer in front of everybody. God, here's my prayer. Now, however you want to open up your prayer. Dear God, Father God, heaven. Dear God, let the sun stand still over Gibeon and the moon over the valley of Ajalon. Now, if this is your commander-in-chief, here's your leader, and he's praying for God to let the sun stand still so you can go out and finish killing everybody. This is his prayer. But if you read on in verse 13. So the sun stood still. So he asked God to make the sun stand still. And now the sun has stood still. He says, so the sun stood still and the moon stayed in place until the nation of Israel had defeated its enemies. Is this event not recorded in the book of Joshua? That's Joshua. The sun stayed in the middle of the sky and it did not set as on a normal day. There has never been a day like this one before or since when the Lord answers such a prayer. Surely the Lord fought for Israel that day. What an amazing prayer that Joshua prayed. That he would pray that the sun would stand still, like the earth would just kind of pause. Because we know that the sun is actually stationary. So it's actually the earth that kind of paused its spinning. It paused in its rotation. But it said God heard this prayer and he answered it. And this is what I love about Joshua, what he taught us. That God hears the prayers of his people. And when it aligns with his plan, his purpose, he will graciously answer those. Is that not awesome? Now, there's some situations that I need the power of God to have his hand upon in my life. And I guarantee you that you have the exact same thing going on in your life, that God, I've got this situation and I need your glory to stand still all over this. Wow, could our faith really resonate with our prayers? See, I think a lot of times that our prayers and our faith don't align. Like we pray these things and we'll put this little clause at the end and we'll say, if the Lord's will. Almost like we're giving away to a wimpy God instead of saying, God, I'm praying your power over this situation. Sun, stand still over this so I can defeat my enemies, so I can overcome my boss, so I can overcome my families. This is what God can do when our faith lines up with what we're actually praying. But too many times I think we're crying out in defeat already. God, I see no hope in this situation. God, I don't know how you can do this. Whatever you want. I mean, what if we actually believe the prayers that we pray? Do you think we could change the world? Absolutely. With all my heart, I believe we can change the world if the prayers of God's people would match up with their faith. I'm talking about this great faith. Joshua had faith. He prayed for the sun to stand still, and it stood still. Is that not awesome? That we could pray and have that kind of power and authority, that we can call on the power of God to come down, and the sun would stand still so we could defeat our enemies, so we could go into battle. This is what Joshua did. You're talking about awesome. This is awesome. And God heard this prayer. And I like what it said there, that there's never been another day like this. There's never been another day like this. You're like, okay, well, Joshua is this great big man of God. He was this man. He walked with God. Him and God were just close. They were really tight. He could quote all the books of the Bible, and he knew everything. Okay, let me show you another boy. A boy. This is in 1 Samuel chapter 3. Here's another prophet. Here's another man of God. But this boy was different. His mom, Hannah, had prayed for him. She fasted for him. And when she finally got pregnant, she finally gave birth to this boy, she made a promise to God and said, God, if you will give me a son, I will give him back to you. So after she'd weaned him, gotten a nurse in him, she took him to the priest, Eli. Said, Eli, here's my son. He's yours. She gave him to the priest for him to use and raise there right in the temple of God. And in 1 Samuel chapter 3, here's what happens. This is verse 10. And the Lord came and called as before, Samuel, Samuel. And Samuel replied, speak, your servant is listening. And in verse 11, then the Lord said to Samuel, I'm about to do a shocking thing in Israel. And here's what's awesome. Eli is the priest. He has sons. They're priests. And they're all living in the same house. And God comes to speak. But it's not the priest that hears. It's not even the priest's son. They're priests too. They don't even hear from God. But this small boy is the one that hears the word of God. This small boy. This little boy. All these priests, all these godly people are around. But nobody hears from God except this little boy. Now here's one of my favorite stories in the Bible. That God can pick and choose anybody he wants to carry out his plan. Joshua, God used him. And now Samuel, God's using him. You see Samuel throughout these next two chapters, and what he does, he even anoints the king of Israel. The first king of Israel, his name is Saul. Later on, Saul became very wicked. And so God told Samuel to go anoint the new king. And it was a little small boy who was around 12 years old. We know him as David, who slew the giant, who became a great king, and who led the nation of Israel. God can choose anybody he wants. Anybody he wants. I get so sick and tired of people saying, oh, you're too young to do that. You're too old to do that. You're too fat to do that. You're too skinny to do that. You got too much hair. You got no hair. You can't do that. Because God can choose whoever he wants to do whatever he wants. He's God. He can do whatever he wants. And if he wants to use a little boy to do his work, he can do that. If he wants to use an old man, he can do that too. He chose Abraham. God can choose anybody He wants to carry out His work. Whenever we started this church, and I was told I was too young. You're too young to start a church. What? God's the one who called us to do it. Let's do it. It's God. He was with Joshua. Don't you think He's going to be with me? I mean, He was with here right now. Here He is as we're reading right now with Samuel. I mean, God was with Samuel. Don't you think He's going to be with us? Absolutely. Where is our faith at? It goes back to Joshua about our faith and our prayers matching up. Don't you think it's kind of sad that Christians are telling other Christians they can't do something when we serve a great Almighty God who created everything? Where is our faith at? I mean, I believe in this God, right? I mean, He created everything. He spoke and created man from dust. That's my God. Don't tell me I can't do something. Don't tell me God can't do something. He can do something. Don't tell me God can't provide a way. Is this not what He did here with the flood? Did God not provide a way? He did. And He protected. God provided a way. God promised Abraham, hey, I'm going to make you into a great nation. He had one son. That one son had two sons. That son had 12 sons that birthed the nation of Israel. God came through on His promises. It came to the very end that they started wondering and doubting, God, I don't know if You're with us. And then God used Moses and they crossed over on dry ground through the Red Sea. God did this. Where is our faith at? It is lies in our doubts that we allow Satan to rob us of the goodness and glory of God. I believe God. And if He chooses to use a little boy, then by God, He can use me. He can use you to do whatever He wants. I have more faith in God than I do myself. Because there's somebody living inside of me, and that's Jesus. And He can choose to use us however He wants. I believe that we all have situations that we face. And sometimes it seems so weak. It seems like there's no hope, like there's no way. But with God, oh, there's a way. There's absolutely a way. And God tries to use these unbelievable miracles to do great things. And He chooses to use us. You got obstacles that you need to face? You can face them with the power of God. We can see all through these events how God was with us. And now these prophets, they're going out proclaiming the Word of God. Here's what God says. Here's what God says. And proclaim it to the people. And they believe it. Sometimes they doubt it. And every time that they doubt God, they end up getting into trouble. Every time. God can choose whoever He wants to, regardless of their qualifications. Yes, you may have had a terrible past. Yes, you may be old in your idea. Yes, you may be young. Yes, you may not have enough money. But with God, I believe with all my heart that all things are possible. With God, He can choose whoever He wants to do whatever He wants. If you read over to the New Testament, He chose a 14-year-old girl to be the birth of the Son of God. We know her as Mary. You can read about this in Luke chapter 2. Most scholars believe she was around 14 years old when God chose her to give birth to the Messiah, Jesus. God can choose whoever He wants. It's our job to believe Him for the impossible. That's my favorite thing. I love that. These prophets, they're all throughout the Bible. You can read about them and their stories. It goes, well, you can pick it up in Leviticus and see how God kind of leads these people. And it kind of keeps right on going how God leads these people through these amazing stories. And all these prophets taught us something different. There's one more I want to share because this one is one of my favorites. One of my favorite prophets. This is in 1 Kings chapter 18. I already told you a little bit about how Joshua prayed these unbelievable prayers. There's this other man. His name is Elijah. Now this man could pray. He prayed. God told him, He said, go see the king and tell him it's not going to rain. So Elijah prayed and went to go see King Ahab. He said, King Ahab, because of you and your wickedness, it is not going to rain for 3 years. Elijah prayed and God shut the heavens. It didn't rain. It quit raining. This man closed up the waters of heaven that it wouldn't rain. God told him to go back and he said, okay, Elijah, it's been a few years now. I want you to go back to the king. Address him. So Elijah goes up to the king and he challenges him. Through this, the king now, they've been leading people through this false worship. And he said, we're going to choose and see whose God is the right God. They've been worshiping this false God called Baal. They just made it up. They just made up this God and they called it Baal. And so what Elijah did, he said, here's what we're going to do. We're going to have a challenge. We're going to put up two sacrifices. We're going to have an altar here. We're going to have an altar here. And you can address your rocks and your wood. And you lay a bull upon yours. And then I will lay the rocks and the wood and lay a bull upon mine. And what we'll do is we'll take turns. I'll let you go first. And you can call upon your god Baal. And whosoever god answers down with fire, that god will be the god. They accepted the challenge. He gave them the opportunity, and they prepared their rocks and their altar, and they had the stack on, and then they had the bull and the light upon it, and then they began to call upon their God. Hours went by with silence in response. It became late in the day, and they wonder what's happening here. Our God is gone. What's going on here? Elijah's over here, and he says, "Guys, why don't you cry out louder? Maybe he's asleep, or maybe he went to the bathroom to relieve himself." And you can read that in the Bible. It's really there. That's why the Bible's awesome. So he's making fun of them and he's calling out to them, "Cry out louder." So they begin to cry out even louder. "Oh, Baal, hear us." And so they take out their knives and they begin to gash themselves as blood pours from their veins onto this altar. Hundreds of these prophets are dancing around this altar, calling upon this false god, and nothing is returned. Not a word. It's dead silence except for their screams. It became late in the evening, and Elijah said, "All right, guys, enough's enough. It's my turn now." Well, they were dancing around the altar. They had kind of damaged it. So what Elijah did, he repaired it and he fixed the rocks and he fixed the wood and he had the bull laid up there. He used their own altar. He said, "Hey, guys, this is not good enough. Let's dig a trench around this." And so they took shovels and they dug a trench around the altar. He says, "All right, now go get me a barrel full of water." Now remember, it hadn't rained in 3 years. There's a drought. And he's asking for a great big barrel of water. They bring the man the barrel of water. He says, "Now pour it on everything." And so they pour it on top of the bull. And water runs down the bull and upon the wood. And now it fills a little trough, a little ditch that they had dug around the altar. He says, "All right, guys, go get me another barrel." Again, it hadn't rained. Water's a little scarce. But they go grab him another barrel and they pour it on top of that sacrifice. He says, "Let's go do it another time." So they do it a third time and grab this barrel of water and they pour it upon the sacrifice. And water runs down, covering the bull, soaking up the wood onto the rocks. And now the water is standing inside the trench. And this amazing man of God, Elijah, he prays one of the most simplest, powerful prayers you'll ever read in the Bible. And if this doesn't show you the power of God, nothing will. This is in 1 Kings 18. Here is all Elijah said. This is verse 36. And it said, "At the usual time for the offering of the evening sacrifice, Elijah the prophet walked up to the altar and he prayed." Now listen to his prayer. "O Lord, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, prove today that you are God in Israel and that I am your servant. Prove that I have done this all at your command. O Lord, answer me, so these people will know that you, O Lord, are God, and that you have brought them back to yourself." And that was all of his prayer. That was it. That's all he prayed. That simple. And many times we think that our prayers have to be long and drug out, and that we've got to cry great big tears. And we've got to pray for hours. That took him about 20 seconds to pray that. And in verse 38, here's God's response. Remember, they cried out all day and didn't get nothing, but here's what my God did. This is verse 38. "Immediately, the fire of the Lord flashed down from heaven, and it burned up the young bull and the wood and the stones and the dust, and it licked up all the water in the trench. And when all the people saw it, they fell down on the ground and cried out, 'The Lord, He is God.'" Yes, the Lord, He is God. This is all Elijah prayed. And they had this water that had filled up everything. They removed all doubt. Elijah prayed the fire of God down upon this altar so that it would prove that He is God. And God heard that prayer. He prayed the fire of God down and it fell. And it removed the bull. It removed the wood. It removed the rocks. It even took the dust and the water that was in the trench. Oh, but these other guys, they cried all day for a false god that they had made, and nothing was returned. When Elijah prayed, the fire of God fell upon that place. I don't know about you, but I want the fire of God in my life to radiate through me and to its people. The fire of God to fall down upon our situations. The fire of God that we can prove that God, He is God. Nobody else. God. You want proof that God is the God? Here's your proof. It's right here in the pudding. That God answered with this fire. And it consumed it all. And it all started because one man prayed a simple prayer. And immediately, God responded. This goes back to what Joshua did about our prayer and our faith lining up. Do we believe God or do we doubt God? I believe God is who He says He is. He's our God. And right here in this story, He prays this unbelievable fire down from heaven. And here's the pattern that these people, they believe God for the impossible. Can we believe God for the impossible? Can we do that? Can I share one of my favorite Bible verses with you? This is Luke 1:37. And I love this. It's one of my favorites in all the Bible. And this is when Mary, little teenager, 14-year-old Mary, found out that she was going to have birth to Jesus the Messiah. And she said to the angel, Gabriel said, How can this be? I've never been with a man before. I've never slept with a man before. And the angel responded, for with God, nothing is impossible. Do we believe God for the impossible? Do we believe that God can send the fire down upon our lives? I believe with all my heart. I believe He can set Weber City on fire, and it can start right here. Tomorrow, we're going to have tons of kids, around 3,700 kids going to Scott County school system. Do we believe that the God can set our schools on fire? Absolutely. But our prayers and our faith are going to have to match up. And this is what the prophets taught us in the Old Testament. What happens when you believe God for the impossible? When God says He's going to do something, He will do it. It's a matter of whether or not we believe Him. I believe God. There's these other people in the Bible, and they kept doing amazing, great things. You can read about these all throughout the Old Testament. So many of them. And there's good ones, and we can't touch on all of them, but I do want to touch something else because some of these prophets did something that was a little crazy. They talked about future events that was going to happen. But see, they had the anointing of God upon them. This one that I want to share with you, this is Isaiah 7:14, that God revealed to him what was going to happen in the future later on in what we know as the New Testament. This is Isaiah 7:14, and I love this. And it says, in verse 14, he says, all right then, the Lord Himself will give you the sign. Look, the virgin will conceive a child. She will give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. And we sung that song earlier. Emmanuel. God, I'm not going to sing it because I can't sing, but we sung the song earlier. And here's what he's talking about. Around 1,500 years before Jesus was born, he is predicting the future. God has given him this vision of Jesus the Messiah that's coming. Behold, a virgin will conceive and give birth to this child. And his name is Emmanuel. God is with us. And get this, it happened. Is that not awesome that the Bible is true? That this very thing happened. And this was awesome. This is why I love this. That I've got all these other props to kind of help us with this. And this is one of my favorite ones because this is really cool. This actually did belong to my dad. I think I bought them and never returned them. This is just they're not that good, so it really doesn't matter. They're binoculars. Now, what the binoculars are great for, and hunters use these a lot, that it helps you to see things that you normally can't see. It amplifies what's really far ahead, and it brings it up close. And this is what these other prophets did. They prophesied. So we learned about these prophets and how they taught us what we can do with the power of God and believing God for the impossible. And then they also predicted the future. They could show things and tell things to people that others can't see. See, with binoculars, you can find a deer that's 1,000 yards away that you can't see with your own eyes. And it's awesome. And if you're really up close to people, whoa. All right, I'm going to try to find my sister in the very back. Wave, Wendy. wow, she's like this big in here. And if I could show you, I would. I mean, obviously she's not that big, but in here she is, because it amplifies what's really, really out there and brings it really close. And here's what these prophets did as they prophesied, as they taught about the future that God revealed to them. God showed this prophet Isaiah that there's coming a man, Jesus. He's going to be born of a virgin. He's going to be the Savior of the world. And this is what these prophets did. They could see into the future because God revealed that to them. And I love this. And it didn't just start. I mean, this wasn't just like a random event. There's many of these throughout the Old Testament, how they proclaimed what was going to happen in the future. If you look in Zechariah 9, you can see what else kind of happened. We're not going to touch on everything, but here's just something else that happened. This is Zechariah 9 and how God spoke. I love this. This is verse 1. He says, verse 9. It says, "Rejoice, O people of Zion. Shout in triumph, O people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you. He is righteous and victorious, yet he is humble, riding on a donkey's colt." Now this is what we know as Jesus' triumphal entry. This is right before he's getting ready to be led to the cross. He's riding on a donkey into town, this young colt. He's riding, and he's kind of riding on it, and they're laying what's known as, we know it as Palm Sunday, laying these palm branches in front of him. And they're calling out, "Hosanna, Hosanna." And this happens 1,000 years before this. I mean, they're predicting this future, this prophecy, because they can see things that other people can't see, because God is the one who has opened their eyes. God is their binoculars. Isn't that awesome? What happened if God would be our binoculars, that we could see things that other people can't see, all because of our faith? Here's what these people taught us, these prophets in the Old Testament. It kind of gets a little sad from here, because not only did it predict Jesus' birth, not only did they predict about his life, in Psalm 22, verse 16, here's what they predicted. It said, "My enemies surround me like a pack of dogs. An evil gang closes in on me. They have pierced my hands and feet. I can count all my bones. My enemies stare at me and gloat. They divide my garments among themselves and throw dice for my clothing." In this, they're predicting Jesus' death on the cross. As they pierce his hands and feet and nail him to the cross, and as these soldiers are standing by, they actually are gambling for his garments. And this was predicted so many years ago, before Jesus ever died on the cross. All because Jesus, God had revealed to them. They gave them the looking glass. And God revealed this unto them. And now they're sharing this unto the people. And so because of this, they're able to see, we're able to see, that God has a plan. Just as he did with Noah and the flood, God has a plan. And sometimes we can't see the plan. We can't see it. One of my favorite things to do with my younger brother was to aggravate him. When we were younger, and we'd be playing, we called it playing war. We'd be on forts all day, and we'd have binoculars. And he would have these binoculars looking, and I would cover the eyes of it up. And he'd be holding it up here, and like, "Guys, I can't see nothing. It's black." And we're like, "Hee, hee, hee." Because we were actually covering them up. I think of many times that we have scales over our eyes, and we sometimes are just like, "God, I don't want to see. I choose not to see. God, I choose not to believe you," or I choose. "I just don't see how you can do it. I don't see how you can get me out of this situation." Here we are, we're in a bleak situation. God, I have no idea how you're going to get us through it. But God's saying, "Why don't you just quit focusing on your view and you look at things through my view? Because from my view, oh, things are looking pretty good. Yes, your world looks like it's going a little bit crazy. But from my point of view, I've already written the last part of the book. I know what happens. The future's in my hands. I'm the one who sent the fire down. I'm the one who protected Noah through the flood. Don't you think I've got a plan for you?" Praise God, He's got a plan for us, and I believe His plan. Do we believe His plan? Yes, your situation, it seems like sometimes it's so bleak. It seems like there's no way that any good thing can happen out of it. Whether it be, I speak a lot about your marriage and your job because we all face these things. We all face families and we all have jobs and we're all trying to figure out how we can make money and pay our bills and send our kids to college. In a nutshell, that's what we're all trying to do. As we're trying to get to heaven. Somewhere through there, you're going to throw in Disney World or a vacation, but basically we're all in the same boat. Make money, pay our bills, get to heaven, maybe have a vacation. Now, how can we go through life and do this? Here's how. We look at it through God's eyes. We got to quit looking at things through our eyes. Yes, it does not make sense. It makes no sense to me how God can use Moses to do these amazing miracles and walk on dry ground. Science tells us this is impossible. But with God, He makes the impossible possible when we believe Him. I believe God for the impossible. We got to get a new set of eyes. And it comes through God. You want a new set of eyes? You can get that this morning. That you put up your eyes, you hang your glasses up, and you put on God's. You can see things through His perspective. Now, there's a problem with this. There's another prophet. This is the last prophet of the Old Testament. And he said some things that kind of trouble people. And we can read through the Bible, and we can read things, and it troubles us. This is Malachi chapter 4, and it starts with verse 1. As this last prophet in the Old Testament speaks. And here's what he says. He said in verse 1, "The Lord of heaven's armies says, the day of judgment is coming, burning like a furnace. On that day, the arrogant and the wicked will be burned up like straw. They will be consumed, roots, branches, and all." Now what he's predicting is far beyond Jesus' birth, death, and resurrection. His is even after what we know as the rapture and the great tribulation. He's talking about these very last events that happens whenever we will stand in judgment before God. Those two groups of people. Those who are saved, those who belong to God, and those who are not saved that don't belong to God. And those that do not belong to God, here's what he's talking about. The day of judgment is coming, burning like a furnace. We know this is the lake of fire or the fiery pits of hell. That these days the arrogant and the wicked, they'll be burned up like straw. And it's kind of sad because he says they'll be consumed, roots, branches, and all. Nothing left. No hope of survival. See, as long as a tree gets burned, there's a little bit of root left. There's still hope. What he's saying is all hope will be removed. And this is kind of sad. And as we're going to talk about in 2 weeks, this is what's going to happen in the very end times. The very last, we're going to talk a little bit about Revelation, the very last things that happened, and he predicts this. He predicts this. And he goes on to say, and this is verse 5, and again, he's talking about a time in tribulation. He says, "Look, I'm sending you the prophet Elijah." Now, we talked about Elijah just a few minutes ago. He says, "I'm sending you the prophet Elijah before the great and dreadful day of the Lord arrives." And verse 6, "His preaching will turn the hearts of fathers to their children and the hearts of children to their fathers. Otherwise, I will come and strike the land with a curse." And you'll learn about this here in 2 weeks in tribulation. Elijah, that we talked about a little bit ago, that he prayed this fire down from heaven. Here's what's so wicked awesome about Elijah is that he never died. Later on, he had a protege. His name was Elisha, not Elijah, but Elisha. That was his right-hand man. And God sends down this chariots of fire and grabs Elijah and takes him straight on up to heaven. God did that. Later, Elijah is going to come back in the book of Revelation. You'll see him. This is going to be happening during the Great Tribulation, and you'll see this in 2 weeks. And here's what he's predicting, is Elijah's return. Elijah's return. And this is all into the book of Revelation. When he says that I'm going to come and I'm going to strike the land with a curse. And this curse is the judgments that God's going to pour out on this earth. And I know this may seem a little bit confusing. I'm just barely touching on this right now because in 2 weeks you're going to have a better idea what happens during the tribulation and the Jesus return and the rapture and the end judgment. You'll have a better idea about that in 2 weeks. But here's my point. Here's this prophet and he's proclaiming all these good news that's happened and also this bad news. And we know this. But what many of us do is we choose to ignore. And I'm just curious, how many of y'all have an iPod? You have an iPod or an iPhone? You use your headphones when you work out and stuff? Now, this is what's awesome. Is that I like to use this sometimes at night so I don't hear myself snoring. And what's cool about this is that I can put these plugs in, and it's already blocked out some of the, I can't hear as good. And so I've got this playlist here. Let me see if I can find it. It said my battery's about dead. Here we go. All right, so here's what we do, is that whenever we do this and we put these earphones in, we can kind of block out everything else so we only hear what we want. Now, if you go to the gym, there's a lot of people that wire these. It's kind of funny because some of them, they're actually singing and they don't realize you can hear them. It's kind of funny. And so I just played the song, so it's playing. And so right now, all I'm hearing is this song. And I can't tell how loud I am. And I see some of you are laughing. I'm going to try to speak a little bit louder. I can barely hear myself now. And now I'm going to talk. Okay, I was talking really loud there. And what we do is that we'll put these earphones in, or we'll put life in, or whatever we're focusing on. And we'll focus on this so we can drown out everything else. This is what we do in life. If you have kids, sometimes you like to just get away and stick things in your ears so that way you don't hear everything else that's going on, right? Oh, yeah. It's good. Sometimes you try to turn the TV up just a little bit louder just so you can hear it just a little bit better. And I can still hear this and right here. I don't know if you can hear this or not. I'm going to try to pick up the mic. I don't know if y'all can hear that or not. So we put these earphones in. So we can kind of block everything else out. And these are like these new iPhone, iPod things. And man, they are like really awesome because it blocks out everything. Like when I do this, I can't hear anything else. This is all that I hear right now. And this is like pretty cool. But this is what we do in life. Now, I'm going to have to turn this down. Okay, so I turned this down. So now I still got these earplugs in, so I can hear myself a little bit better now. But as soon as I turn this up, I start getting sucked into it. And you just start hearing it. And you go to the gym and you're seeing these people work out, and this is what they're doing. Lose yourself in the music, the moment. I'm not going to sing it all, but anyway, you hear this stuff and it's going on. But here's what we do in life. We will choose to do this rather than this. God is speaking loud and clear to His people, but the problem is that we would rather hear this. We'd rather block out all this other instead of seeing what God would choose us to see. He's saying, guys, here's the future. Here's what's happening. But the reason why we're not hearing it is because we are so sucked into life, so focused on ourselves. And God's saying, guys, here's the future. Here's the prediction. Here's what's going to happen. I'm going to send you Jesus. He's going to die. He's going to raise again to give you hope and give you life. Then after that, there's going to be a time that the church is going to come alive. And it's going to be birthed. Then after that, I'm going to send Jesus back, and He's going to gather up all of His people, take them on to heaven. Then after this, there's going to be 7 years of a great tribulation. And then after that, Jesus is going to come back, and there's going to be a great battle of Armageddon. And forevermore, there's going to be this judgment. And there's this warning going off to people, but instead, we're here with our earphones in, going through life, working out, choosing to ignore all what God has said. See, what happens after this last word, this very last word of Malachi, it's a dark time. See, the nation of Israel, they're used from hearing from God. They have these prophets, and they're used to hearing it. But between the Old and New Testament, between the last verse in Malachi and the first verse in Matthew, 400 years pass, and nobody hears from God. There's no prophets. There's no prayers. It's silent. Silent. Doesn't this silence seem a little awkward? I mean, just a minute ago, I was so excited and we was jamming down. And now, it's silent. Now, we have silence for one of two things. One of two things. Either God is not speaking, or we're not listening. My question to you as we wind this up today, which one are you? Are you the one that God is speaking to? That you come to church when you've got your Bible read and you're excited to hear a word from God so you can leave out these doors changed? Or are you the one that's coming and you don't get a thing? It's like you got your earphones in and it's just you. I don't know where you may be at right now in your life. I don't know where you may be at right now in your walk. But as we see God leading us through all these things, from the creation to the fall to the flood to the Tower of Babel and the different languages to the birth of a nation to this leading of Exodus to the Ten Commandments. From there, we've got these prophets and how they're speaking to us, God's anointed word, and how they're prophesying into the future. They're giving us a glimpse of what's going to happen. We have life that can get in our way. And this is where many of us are at. Oh man, but you don't understand what I'm going through. They're talking layoffs at work. You don't understand what life is like at my house. Like it's like I'm living in the very depths of hell at my household. It's rough. And I don't hear from God at all. Why are we not hearing from God? It's one of two things. Either we're not listening or God's not speaking. My question to you is right now is how is God speaking to you right now? Don't get me wrong. There's times that we open up our Bible and we're like, okay, God, I'm going to hear from you. And this is why I like my iPad because I can turn anywhere really, really fast. And we'll read the Bible and like, okay, God, I have no idea what I just read. And sometimes there's things that affect us and it's sin. And God reminds us, hell, just like this fruit, you have sin in your life and you're going to have to get this out. Okay, God, I confess my sin to you. I'm sorry, you're right. I had sin in my life. See, I think what God's calling His people to do is to walk just a little bit closer to Him so that we might be able to share with others His amazing love. People are looking somewhere. What do they see in us? Do they just see people that just goes to church? Maybe you got a U on the back of your car, but you drive like a hellion. Kindly remove your sticker. I'm just kidding. We all get road rage. It's fine. But what do people see in us? What do they see? Is God's... We might be able to do something different in our lives. Is God speaking to us in such a way that we can react? 400 years of silence. And then God finally speaks. He speaks to this woman in the Bible. Her name is Elizabeth. She's getting fairly old. And this angel comes down and proclaims, says, Elizabeth, I know you're old, but you're going to have a baby. You read over, next chapter over, this angel comes down again and speaks to Mary, this 14-year-old teenager, and says, Mary, you're going to carry the Son of God in your womb. 400 years, and then God speaks about these two births. I don't know what you need to rebirth in your life right now, but God has got an amazing life for you. We already see about how He predicted the future and how He led and guided all these prophets and how He spoke His word. And you can read all throughout the Old Testament. You can see how God led and how He guided. But how is He guiding our lives right now? I mean, we're seeing this right now. But how are we living? So this one last man I want to mention right fast. He was Jonah in the Bible. And We played this at the very beginning about this that little girl telling the story of Jonah. He had a choice to make. God spoke to him and said, Jonah, I've got a job just for you. I want you to go to the city of Nineveh and tell them that I'm coming. And he says, no. And he runs away. He goes down to the city of Joppa and he gets on a ship and he goes out. We know the story later on. These soldiers, they're crying out. What are we going to do? They throw him overboard. He gets swallowed by a fish. And here he is inside the belly of a fish. I don't know how. I don't know how it works. All I know is the Bible said that it was in there. And I believe with all my heart that Jonah was in there. Scientists are trying to prove this. I mean, I don't believe he was down there with the campfire trying to keep warm. I believe it was a nasty, slimy, stinking mess. Because fish can only eat other fish. And even though I like fish, 3 days of old fish smell, I'm going to smell sort of rotten. I don't believe it was a pleasant experience. He actually refers to this as hell. He was in hell in the belly of this fish. And inside the belly of this fish, in the darkness, and in the slimeness and the goo, as he refers to as hell, he cries out to God. And he repents. God causes the fish to vomit him up, and it vomits him up onto the beach. God comes again and says, Jonah, I have a job for you to go to the city of Nineveh and tell them that I'm coming. He says, yes, sir. He goes, and you would think that he would be super excited and super charged up, that he would preach the longest message you've ever heard. But instead, he has a one-sentence sermon. One sentence. It lasts for about 5 seconds. He gathers up all the people and he says, City of Nineveh, God is going to destroy this city. And he says, I'm done. And he walks away. That is his message. This resonates with the people. The king declares a fast. Everybody puts on sackcloth. They put ashes on their head and they start crying out to God. And God heard their prayers and he doesn't destroy that city. All because one man heard from God and did what he said. Now here's my challenge to you. What would happen if we would hear from God and do what he says? I believe that we could change the world. Everybody's focusing on homosexuality. They're focused on presidency right now. What if we focused on just hearing from God and doing what he says? Just hear from God and do what he says. The city of Nineveh was saved. Do you think that our families could be saved? Could our jobs be saved? Could our lives be saved? Could our whole entire culture be saved? If we would hear from God and do what he says. But all boils back to this one concept. Are you hearing from God? I want to ask you to bow your head and close your eyes just for a moment as we pray. Father God, how great and awesome you are. And I pray right now that your Holy Spirit would speak into us. Reveal to us your word. Reveal to us, God, as you speak. As you continue to pray, I want to ask you this question. That is God speaking to you? It's either yes or no. First, I want to talk to the people that says yes. God's speaking to me. God's speaking to me. He wants me to do something, just like Jonah. He wants me to act on something. God is speaking to me. I want to pray for you first. Whatever God is leading you to do, I want to pray for you. Nobody's looking around. It's between me and you and God. I just want to pray for you. God is speaking to you to act and move and do something. I want to pray for you. Hands are already going up. God is speaking and moving in your life. You want to obey God. I want to pray for you. Just slip your hand up and say, pray for me. God is speaking to me. Hands are still going up. I want to pray for you. God is speaking to me. I want to act. God is speaking to me. I want to pray for encouragement, faith, peace. God is speaking to me. I just want to pray for you. I want to pray for you. God, I pray right now that you'd move and work among your people. May we be like Jonah, not when he ran away, but when he accepted the challenge. May we be the very key that can save an entire city, all because we're hearing from you and doing what you say. God, I pray right now for all these, that right now you're speaking to them in their lives. God, that you would fill them up, God, as they proclaim whatever it is that you would have them to do. Whether it's words, whether it's an action, whether it's a deed, that you would lead them and guide them in such a way, God, that they would feel your powerful presence in their lives, just like Jonah, as they do what you are leading them to do. As you continue to pray, there's another group of people here today And maybe you come to church every week, or maybe you read your Bible and you're like, man, I'm not hearing from God at all. There's some things that can be in the way. Most of the time it's sin in our lives. It gets in the way. Sometimes we doubt God. Sometimes we have no idea how God can save us from our situation that we're in. This silence right now is kind of awkward. We need to hear from God. We can't address every situation. We can't address everybody. But some of you here today, you need to call out on God right now. You need to get this sin out of your life so you can clearly hear from God. Would you call on God right now? Call on God right now. Say, God, forgive me. I come back to you. God, forgive me so that I can hear from you. There's others of you here today that you don't belong to God. That's why you don't hear from Him. That you're as far from God as you can possibly be. That if you were to close your eyes in death today, you would not wake up at the pearly gates. You need to belong to God. If that's you today, would you call it on? These prophets have spoke. You've heard God's word today. He wants you. He wants you to hear from Him. Would you call it on God right now and say, God, save me. Take my life and make me brand new. Forgive me of my sins. I accept Jesus as my Savior. Thank you for new life. Now you have mine. Nobody's looking around, heads are bowed, eyes are still closed. If you prayed that prayer today to receive Jesus as your Savior, would you just slip your hand that I may pray for you? You just slip your hand and say, I had prayed that prayer today. God, I pray right now that you'd move and work and do an amazing, great work in our lives. That you'd fill us up, God, with your awesome glory, that we might be able to radiate your love. God, we don't want you to go dark. We don't want you to go silent in our lives. We want you to be vivid. We want to hear from you, God, and I pray that all of us, God, would do what you say. That as we grow closer to you and as we grow closer to one another, that we'd be excited and that we would boldly do, God, what you want us to do. May we not hear silence, God, but may we vividly hear your word as we read it and as we come to church. And God, today when we walk out of these doors, we're going to be different than when we got here, because today we've heard a word from you. God, we love you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you give God some awesome praise today? I love you, God. You're awesome. Absolutely awesome.